Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to declare the first session open. We're still awaiting one member, but he's the respondent, so he can catch up later. And I'm not going to introduce all my speakers because we've all been reading the newsletters and seen the website, and it would only eat into their time. So I'm simply going to declare this session open. What should the limits of OED's coverage be? And I'm going to hand over to our first speaker, who is Jonathan Green, who's going to be speaking on documenting slang. Take it away, Jonathan.
Take it away, my understanding. Watchers, they say in slang. Right, let me try this. Okay. The current OED offers just over 7,700 terms that are labelled slang. My own database, since research has moved on since my dictionary was published in 2010, has around 54,000 headwords, and the headwords nest about 125,000 terms. The OED and Green's dictionary don't overlap, although we do sometimes. They exclude some things. I'm a specialist. I'm more likely to put a much wider remit. Point being that the slang lexis, like all lexis, continues to expand. So what I'm asking, and since I'm here, I assume the OED is also asking, is a simple question. What is to be done about slang? We know what slang is. The OED defined it in 1911 as the language of a highly colloquial type, considered as below the level of standard educated speech and consisting either of new words or of current words employed in some special sense. Given that colloquialism is not a perfect synonym for slang, I assume this will be revised in the very near future. There are lots of alternative suggestions, both expert and amateur. Linguistically minded colleagues have laid down rules for its identification. My slang predecessor, Eric Partridge, has 17 such rules. The lexicologist, Julie Coleman, 11. America's Jonathan Leiter, a lexicographer, 4. I offer none. I'm phobic of commitment. I offer merely a synonym, the counter language, which I don't deny for a second reflects my own many years younger involvement in what was then called the counterculture of the 60s, but what it really does is underpins the innate oppositional subversive role of slang. So what is slang? This is slang. I'm not going to read it out. What it comes from the Swell's Night Guide, which was one of many guides put out in the 19th century to low-life London. But so also is this. This is actually, if you know hip-hop language, you will see that it is a threat. It comes from grime. The young man who wrote it was unfortunately, I think, on trial for murder at the time. Fortunately, he got let off. So who does define slang? Because how do the young see it? Do they see it? That's slang over there. I don't do field work. It doesn't yield results. Slang itself is seen as forward-looking. I remain tied to traditional research, reading, in other words, in print or online. But researching a paper on multi-ethnic London English, which is a blend of rap, Jamaican patois, homegrown Londonisms, and mainstream American and British slang, which is slang's current British, UK's cutting edge, I read an interview with a teenage Londoner, very fluent. How would he describe his language? Slang. And would he use it forever? No. So what would he speak as an adult? Cockney. Problem there is, of course, that Cockney is what most of us would describe as slang, but that was standard, except for the fact that, of course, that the MLE, the multi-ethnic London English that he was speaking at the moment, was, as far as he was concerned, standard. Top-down authority, as epitomized by the OED, is, as we know, under siege. We know Wikipedia, but then we have sites like Rap Genius. Rap Genius has allegedly 10 million monthly users, and they have the opportunity to annotate with all the media, multimedia varieties available on the web, any digitized text, Chaucer, Piers Plowman, all the way through rap, classics, contemporary novels, nonfiction, anything. It bills itself as offering what they call participatory education, but probably more realistic is the credo, embrace the chaos. I am, although I've met the man who does it and he's a charming man, no fan of the online urban dictionary because it belies its title. It is neither particularly urban, for which we read black, and it is certainly not a dictionary. If we read for dictionary, a reasonably trustworthy lexical authority. It lacks any kind of lexicographical rigor, but it depends on what people call the wisdom of the crowd, and thus empowered, it lists several million terms and claims that there are 2,000 new slang words every day. In fact, it has recently dropped, or in the last year, dropped the word slang from its self-description, but like Rap Genius, it has a motto, in this case, define your world. And this, to me, is the crux. It would be obtuse for me to suggest for a second that the OED were to drop slang completely, even if I might benefit professionally, but I really have come to wonder whether, to what extent it is only the outsiders, and by outsiders I mean the professional lexicographers who, with the greatest respect, are usually middle-aged or in my case worse, and inevitably, if benevolently voyeuristic, who so determinately put a wall around this subset of the language. The young users, the young coiners, unless pressed by a third party, typically a journalist, don't think like that. On the streets of real life, you do not pause to glossarize. So the question for lexicographers, for the OED, and on a lower level for me, is do we continue to stand over slang like customs officers at a border? And if we do, with what justification? I have to ask, is the label slang still pertinent? Slang, after all, does not even exist in the context of a linguistic subset until it's stated to be such in 1756, and even then the reference is possibly criminal cant. And even if we do, as I do, accept John Simpson's characterization of Bee's New Dictionary of the Canting Crew of circa 1698 as, quotes, the first dictionary of slang, what do we do with all the non-canting, non-criminal, but definitely non-standard material that's found before that? I mentioned Chaucer, a perfect example. Shakespeare, for that matter. The internet continues, as we all know, to rock the world on its foundations, and that extends to historical principles, lexicography. The sense of being able to plant one's feet and thus uphold a universe is gone. The Holy Grail, the first use, has become infinitely mutable. Since publication of my book in 2010, I found 4,500 predates, and this accretion continues. I have no doubt that the OED is walking exactly the same path, albeit guided by different signposts. Yet, while the notoriously fallible Google book search and those databases that are fully searchable allow the targeting even of given terms, the bottom line, I would suggest, still remains the hard graft of reading. But where we once feared not finding sufficient sources, the problem now is assaying enough of the plenitude that's on offer. Equally important with this new digitized accessibility, labeling assumptions have been changed, especially, I find, as regards geographical origins. So I had my print Green's Dictionary of Slang over there, and the word dis, meaning to disparage, to attack verbally, which was number two there, it was 1981, and I think, like most people, everybody would have been quite happy to accept that it was US campus. I think I've got it down there. Well, not on that, at the top, sorry, for both entries, US black and campus. The trouble is that when I'm reading through the Sunday Times of Perth for the year 1905 on the 10th of December, I discover through the Trove database, the national database of old Australian newspapers, that in fact it is there when a journalist rival tries to diss you. It's in a poem. Fact remains that I've twisted it and attacked it and so on. That is the first citation that I have so far found for dis, and it is 76 years older. So bingo, it's not campus and so on and so forth. This is across the board. This change I keep coming across, and I'm sure the OED does as well. What seemed unequivocally US underworld is suddenly in New Zealand being spoken by people of impeccable probity. It all remains fluid. So what do we do with the labeling? Do we abandon hope of accuracy, or do we fine-tune it? The printed page could not be searched in the way a digital screen can, so it didn't have to have that kind of fine-tuning, and in any case, there wasn't the space. Online, of course, there are no longer the constraints of space. But it cuts both ways, because while detail can undoubtedly bring benefits, there remains the fear that in doing so, we get to such a level of fissiparousness that it actually stops benefiting most of the readers, even the scholars who are probably looking at the OED. On the other hand, given the sophistication of the search engines that's on offer, why not offer it? Or do we, as has been proposed by certain dictionaries, even abandon the label slang? As you can imagine, this is fills me with horror, but I've come to believe, looking at those young people earlier and their attitude to it, looking at the enormity of the language, the inability of really putting up these customs borders, that maybe this is what we have to do. Richard Alsop's Dictionary of the Caribbean English Usage, forgive me. This, in fact, is Australian. For instance, opted for three registers: formal, informal, anti-formal. The last, I suppose, being slang. According to Bruce Moore of the Australian National Dictionary, has suggested that in Australia it is considered, and I was hoping Amanda Lorgeson might be here, but is not, that a lot of Australian language, which people rather lazily suggest as slang, are just the wonderful Rococo, Baroque, whatever the right word is, way that Australians speak. Scots, I've come across at a conference recently, saying that, you know, all that stuff in Irvine Welsh, in train spotting, is not actually slang that you think, it's just localisms. That, of course, is the diagram at the beginning of the original OED in the introduction. So if slang is, as it were, to be brought up from the gutter, it must, of course, be subjected to the same constraints as the rest of the OED's candidate words. In theory, it should. As regards chronology, this immediately throws up more problems. Slang, despite the myth, is not especially ephemeral. Booze, for instance, has been around since 1535, and if we want to go back further to the inevitable coarseness, arse can be found for 1000 CE in Abbot Aelfric's Latin to Anglo-Saxon dictionary. There are hundreds and hundreds of veterans. But I can't deny that while standard English has established a lot of its major words, I mean, the buttocks, drink, to go back to those two, slang is based on reinvention, albeit synonymic reinvention there. That's why there's 2,300 words for sexual intercourse or whatever it may be. And it's across themes that have been around for 500 years. I wouldn't offer any special pleading, but I think with slang, the OED, if it's going to embrace it, has got to relax at least some of its rules. I wouldn't, having said that, volunteer my support for the kind of rhyming slang that is based on the true ephemerality of some D-list celebrity. I sometimes get very depressed thinking that I devoted my life to a world in which posh and bex means sex. But there we are. MLE, on the other hand, multi-ethnic London English, is far too important a development, in my opinion, for the OED, let alone myself, to overlook. But again, we have the inevitable problem with slang that MLE speakers, other than in grime and the occasional pop interview, are not particularly MLE writers. And slang across the board is ill-recorded. More than any other register, it stays in the mouth much longer than standard before it appears, I believe this, on the page or on the screen. Thus, sometimes we just can't list the number of examples that an OED entry by the OED rules might wish to have, but I don't think that automatically invalidates these words. So what is to be done? Those words all mean drunk. What is to be done about slang? The OED remains a descriptive dictionary, and for me this means the necessity to acknowledge contemporary as well as historical realities. The dictionary remains an unrivaled lexicographical authority, and as such it surely has no choice but to reflect the world whose words it corrals. Slang, whether we label it or not, whether encountered in the street, the mass media, in cyberspace, and even in that endangered species, the literary novel, has never, in my opinion, been so much part of the world. The great Francis Grose called his slang dictionary the classical dictionary of the vulgar tongue. The great dictionary, the OED, is undoubtedly a classic. I would like to see it embrace and continue to embrace, albeit, of course, on its own terms, the vulgar tongue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Danica Salazar.
All right, so from talking about what to be done about slang, I'm going to talk about what's to be done about world Englishes in the OED, but not only that, what is currently being done. So in 1985, Brash Kashrou introduced this highly influential model of the global spread of English, which places the world's English-speaking territories in three concentric circles, as you can see on this slide. And in the inner circle are countries such as the United Kingdom, the United States, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, which are known as the historic and sociolinguistic centers of English, where it is used as a primary language. Now, in the outer circle are post-colonial nations in Asia and Africa, where English is used alongside local languages as an international and international lingua franca, or rather, intranational and international lingua franca. On the other hand, in the expanding circle are countries where English is learned as a foreign language and is commonly employed as medium of international communication. Now, a considerable amount of research on world Englishes has focused on the outer circle and the emerging indigenized varieties of English within it. My own postdoctoral work is centered on the OED's coverage of a particular outer circle variety, Philippine English. The Philippines, which also happens to be my home country, is a highly multilingual island nation in Southeast Asia, a former American colony where English is widely spoken as a second or third language, and plays an important role in such fields as government, law, business, science, and education. In this brief talk, I will use four B words, so words starting with the letter B, from Philippine English to discuss what I find are the key issues relating to the OED's coverage of world Englishes. So the first word that we will consider is bundok. It can be seen here from the OED entry that this word comes from the Tagalog terms. Tagalog, also known as Filipino, is a local Austronesian language that's used throughout the country. So this word comes from the Tagalog term for mountain, bundok. And bundok is obviously a word of Philippine origin, but as correctly indicated by its OED label, it is much more representative of U.S. slang than of Philippine English. And this makes bundok a very good example of those words of foreign origin that have become assimilated into the vocabulary of the wider English-speaking world. The OED has always been open to such loanwords, and since in most cases these words are admitted into the dictionary based on evidence taken from UK and other inner circle resources, they are far from being the ideal measure of the extent of world English coverage in the OED, especially of words coming from nations in the outer circle, such as the Philippines. Now, the second word I want to show you is balikbayan. I do not have an OED entry to show for this word because it doesn't exist. But like bundok, balikbayan is a borrowing from Tagalog, a compound word made up of the words balik, so that's the verb that we used to mean to return, and the word bayan, which means country. Balikbayans are Filipinos who return home to the Philippines temporarily or permanently after a period of living and working abroad. So the Philippines is one of the world's largest labor exporting nations, and given the sheer number of Filipino migrant workers and their importance to the Philippine economy, so myself included, I guess, a term referring to those who return to the motherland is used very frequently in Philippine English and is, as can be seen from these images, quite productive. So you have terms such as balikbayan visa, deals for balikbayans, then balikbayan box is the care package that people from abroad send home to the Philippines. And books published with titles featuring that word. So now, balikbayan brings me to what I find is one of the first issues regarding the coverage of world Englishes in the OED. So what we have in the case of balikbayan is a word that is obviously of Philippine origin, and in terms of usage is quite clearly characteristic of Philippine English. However, this might be the very reason why balikbayan is not in the OED right now. Some features of this word and of many other world English words like it automatically fail OED's new words assessment criteria. It is not in OED's quotation databases at all. It has a date range of less than 100 years, because in the case of Philippine English and in many other post-colonial English-speaking countries, you cannot find any publications before the early 20th century, because before then, English wasn't used in the Philippines at all. So, And apart from this, since this word is region-specific, there is not much evidence for it in the external databases that the OED routinely searches. We can conclude from this that if more words from world Englishes are to be incorporated in the OED, some changes have to be made to the new word selection criteria to keep them from discriminating against words like balikbayan, which are widely used in the world English variety of origin but are of limited currency in other varieties. So again, this is the relaxing of rules that Jonathan mentioned earlier. There is also a need to supplement current evidence for less widely used varieties, for example, by adding more world English publications in the reading program, which the OED has already started to do. And also, there is the added difficulty that in the case of post-colonial nations such as the Philippines, published texts are still heavily edited following exonormative standards. So British English in most cases, American English in the case of Philippine English. So that means that idiosyncratic vocabulary that we use, perhaps we use frequently in our speech in the Philippines, does not always make it to the print sources that the OED relies on for evidence. So we have to think about what to do about that particular difficulty. Okay, the third word that I want to show you is buntal. This word exemplifies a bias towards a particular type of world English vocabulary that can be observed not only in the OED, but also in other inner circle, widely used inner circle dictionaries such as Webster's. In fact, Bolton and Butler call these terms Webster words, or words referring to local flora, fauna, and ethnic groups that date back to the early years of contact between colonizers and colonized, and between English and local languages. So buntal is just one of the dozens of these Philippine English words that made their way into the OED during a time when frequency was not a criterion for inclusion in the dictionary. These words are undeniably of anthropological interest and deserve a place in a historical dictionary, but their noticeable prevalence over more contemporary lexis results in an imbalance that needs to be properly addressed. So I have on this slide some examples. For names of, if you look for Philippine English in the OED, you mostly will find terms for animals, such as malmag. I cannot remember the last time I ever had to say malmag. So plants and names of ethnic groups. And the predominance of these so-called Webster words also contributes to the idea that world English vocabulary consists mostly of borrowings from exotic languages. This is certainly not the case, as lexical innovation in emerging varieties of English goes beyond loanwords. Philippine English alone uses a wide range of strategies in the creation of new words, some examples of which are reproduced on this slide. So although they are much harder to pinpoint than borrowings, representing these other forms of lexical innovation is another way in which the OED can vastly improve its coverage of world Englishes. So just some examples of these strategies. Adaptive coining. So you have an existing word, viand, which Filipinos adapted in order to express a cultural item that does not exist in the source variety of American English, since rice is our main carbohydrate. So every time you have a meal, there's always rice. So we need a word to identify the protein that goes with the rice. So we say, okay, let's use bayan for that. So then the word took on this other meaning in the Philippines. It doesn't have in other varieties. So, and you also have loan translations, such as we say to go down instead of to get off a vehicle, because that is a direct translation of the Tagalog verb bumaba. So you have a productive compounds, for example, mate being attached to words such as batch and dorm and province. So a person who comes from the same province as you is a province mate. So the conversion of a word from one form, part of speech to another, such as the use of traffic as an adjective. So in Manila, unfortunately, we frequently say things like it's traffic in all parts of the metro instead of there's a lot of traffic. So derivations such as the addition of the suffix able for electoral candidates in terms such as presidentiable, gubernatorial, mayorable, and senatorial. So initialism such as OFW for overseas Filipino worker, and then loan blends when we mix different borrowings from Spanish, our former colonizer before the United States, with Tagalog words and Philippine and in English words. So despedida party is a leaving party. Sari-sari store is a variety store. And then there's also the continued use of words that are already archaic in British or American English, such as comfort room to mean restroom, and salon for lawmaker, or the continued use of thrice. Until I started living in Europe, I didn't know thrice was archaic. I thought it was just like twice, until my British friend said, what? Thrice? You mean three times, right? Yeah, thrice. So, or semantic change. So gimmick in the Philippines means a fun night out with friends. So you can say something like, well, where's the gimmick tonight? Or salvage, ironically enough, means to summarily execute. So there's a debate over where this comes from, but I think because these bodies were being fished, salvaged out of rivers, I think that's where that comes from. So, thank you. So the final word I have is batchmate, another word that is as yet unrepresented in the OED. I've always known this word as a Philippine English word, but upon further investigation, I found out that it's also very commonly used in Indian English, with a slight difference in meaning in the two varieties. In Indian English, the word is used to mean somebody who went to school or police or military training academy the same year as another person. In Philippine English, apart from the school sense, the meaning has also been extended to somebody who has done something the same year as another person, started a job or appeared on SNL, as in the example. So, the case of batchmate brings up the question of how to define the regional limits of world Englishes in the OED. This is interesting not just as an academic exercise, but as it impacts the very practical question of labeling. Can we say, for instance, that there are enough distinctive linguistic features common to Southeast Asian varieties of English to justify a Southeast Asian label? Is this possible given the many differences in colonial background, native languages, and English usage patterns among nations of the region? If not, should labeling then be done by country? But then how does the OED determine which countries deserve their own labels? What should the dictionary do with words like batchmate that appear in different country-specific varieties with different nuances and meaning in each? Labeling is an important issue because it impacts the user experience. All the effort to adequately treat world English words in the OED will be for nothing if its users cannot find them. Right now, anyone who is interested in Philippine English words can only find them through references to the Philippines in the word's definition, etymology, or source, as shown in these examples. So unlike labels for inner circle varieties, such as the UK, US, and Australian English, labels for outer circle varieties in the OED are still rarely and inconsistently applied. When I last checked, only four words in the OED are labeled Southeast Asian, and there's only one entry each with the country labels Burma, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Philippines. OED online users also have the option to browse the dictionary's regional categories, which include one for Southeast Asia. But clicking on this option takes one to a list of 315 different senses, but a closer look at the results reveals that 221 out of these 315 are actually South Asian usages, as the Southeast Asian search refinement option conflates these two very different regions. So this leaves only a few dozen Southeast Asian entries, a number that does not at all reflect the OED's actual coverage of these English varieties. So it is clear that world English labeling in the OED still has a lot of room for improvement. It would also be beneficial for the OED to explore other ways of representing world English data so they can be more accessible to its users, probably with more visual means, such as maps and charts. So in summary, for the OED to provide a more adequate treatment of world Englishes, especially of vocabulary from the outer circles, such as in the case of Philippine English, it needs to first modify its new word selection criteria somewhat to make them more open to region-specific usage, and supplement the comparatively smaller evidence for less widely used varieties. Second, diversify its coverage of world Englishes by removing the bias towards colonial-era flora and fauna terms and exotic loanwords, and giving more attention to contemporary lexis and other types of lexical innovation beyond simple borrowing. And finally, make world English data more accessible to dictionary users by improving its labeling system and offering more visual means of access. And that's about it for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I'm delighted and honored to be here exactly 34 years to the week after I first met Bob Birchfield at Trinity College, Oxford, and began my occasional relationship with the editors of the Oxford English Dictionary. Since the late 1980s, my six lexicographer colleagues at Law Pros Incorporated in Dallas, Texas, have served as legal consultants on legal terminology, and that's always been a very rewarding aspect of our work. I take it as a given that the Oxford English Dictionary is the greatest dictionary ever published in any language, and I've developed 10 propositions that I thought might help make it even better. Publishing lexicography, even scholarly lexicography, has always been a business. And an undercurrent of this entire symposium, it seems to me, is it has to do with the allocation of resources. And that's what Judy Pearsall, it seems to me, was referring to when she talked about prioritizing our editorial work. I speak as a working lexicographer and as a businessman. I've now edited three unabridged editions of Black's Law Dictionary, and these propositions are built on that experience. The first has to do with the core missions of the OED, as I see them, have always been to marshal and define the entire English vocabulary, to array all the historical senses of each term in more or less chronological order, to document the earliest known uses of terms, and finally to provide various kinds of ancillary information. It seems to me that it's possible that the Oxford Dictionary Department is at a crossroads, a decision point about where do we allocate our resources going forward. We know that there's a 10-year plan. It strikes me, and this may be probably, if I'm going to say anything shocking, this will be it. I believe that the length of the Oxford English Dictionary could be trebled if the full vocabulary were marshaled. So I think a lot more of the resources need to go into A, marshaling the English vocabulary, but then again, we have to ask, well, what is it? The core vocabulary, even, and I will be expanding on that as I go through some of these other propositions. Because lexicographic resources are scarce, lexicography is a discipline requiring great skill, and in my experience, many years of training before I can really expect first-rate work from a colleague that I've trained to be a lexicographer, the dictionary department should not stray far from its traditional core missions, marshaling the vocabulary, and as I say, I think the core vocabulary could be trebled depending on how we understand the term lexical unit or headword or lemma. I think it would be a mistake. I was asked to talk about usage because I've also written 2,000 plus page books on English usage and on legal usage. I think it would be a mistake to try to incorporate a lot of usage material into the Oxford English Dictionary. Almost every institutional usage note has, in my view, ended up being quite unsatisfactory. Some people spell sherbet. Some people spell sherbet with an extra R. In fact, it's a majority of Americans, probably. But many people disapprove. Well, who are the people who use it, and who are the people who disapprove? That is under-descriptive, if anything. We recently found, by the way, that in Twitter feeds, Y-O-U-R, your, is used as a contraction, you're late, Y-O-U-R, as opposed to Y-O-U apostrophe R-E, more frequently in American English. You say, well, some people use Y-O-U-R as the contraction for U-R. We don't need usage notes like that that say some people do this, some people do that, some people disapprove, unless we know more about who does this, who does that, and why do the people disapprove? And then you start getting into prescriptivism. I, as a lexicographer, am a complete descriptivist. I think it would be best not to get into prescription in the Oxford English Dictionary. By the way, I also wear another cap as a usage writer, that I'm very prescriptive there. I'm a descriptive prescriptivist. But when it comes to my work on blacks, or when it comes to contributions to the Oxford English Dictionary, it's very important to be descriptive. And when Bob Birchfield occasionally made forays into prescriptivism, as by labeling the word insinuendo, a blend of insinuation and innuendo, he called it a tasteless word. Today that is in the online version of the OED as with the initials RWB at the end of it. My impression of the second edition, I was talking with Edmund about this morning, was that notes like that from Birchfield that were sort of idiosyncratic and quirky were cut from the dictionary. But now that apparently some of them have been added back, or maybe they've always been there, but with his initials, I think getting into usage heavily is a mistake, because when it comes to usage, it really is best that people look at the evidence and decide for themselves what is good usage. Has something been passed into good, current, idiomatic, edited English? One major, it seems to me, undertaking of the OED, and one of its great hallmarks, has always been earliest known uses. So it seems to me that a lot of the resources ought to go to something that's actually quite systematic and more easily done today than ever before, and that is antedating first known uses. Today, a lot of the earliest datings in the OED are demonstrably wrong, and sometimes centuries off. And more than ever before, it is easy to engage in systematic antedating of earliest known uses. Now, I think that a lot of the OED entries need to be regularized throughout the alphabet. I've certainly found that in my own lexicography. If you look at, for example, the T's, the volume for T, topside, the term topside has a full column of entries. But if you look at bottomside in B of the OED, it's barely a line and a half. And it's there as a compound of the word bottom. I found that in my own lexicography, it's very important to do systematic checking, cross-checking, to be sure that there is a kind of proportionality of treatment throughout the dictionary. Now, number six, I think this is probably how you get to trebling the length of the dictionary, phrasal limitation, lemmatization. The editor should rethink whether phrases ought to be treated as compounds under words, or whether phrases ought to be considered, as most American lexicographers treat them, as lexical units that are worthy of being headwords in their own right. And I'll give you an example. The example I gave in the paper that I sent out in advance was diversity jurisdiction. But I thought it would be wrong of me to dwell too much on law, with which I'm associated, but instead to talk about some terms in a totally different field. That is psychiatry. So you take as the example the phrase personality disorder, which at the moment is a compound listed under personality. But in psychiatric terms, the American Psychiatric Association has a whole range of personality disorders that are common diagnoses that the Oxford English Dictionary has no treatment of. For example, histrionic personality disorder, or the OED's treatment of sociopath versus psychopath. The OED actually suggests that the normal term today is psychopath, when in fact that's been out of date for over 60 years. Sociopath is much more frequent. But in fact, the normal noun today is antisocial, which is short for antisocial personality disorder. But you won't find that in the Oxford English Dictionary. That is a lexical unit, antisocial personality disorder. Somebody suffering from it is called an antisocial. There are also something like six different types of antisocials. Or you take histrionic personality disorder, there are appeasing histrionics. Histrionic is commonly used as a noun. Appeasing histrionics, vivacious histrionics. There are symptoms that go with these. They are different types. Tempestuous histrionics. I had an employee who was a tempestuous histrionic. Hence, I've become an expert on this in the last 6 months. Disingenuous histrionics, theatrical histrionics, and infantile histrionics. Six different types, and those are lexical units. Now, whether they should be sub-entries under a noun called histrionic, well, what I'm saying is all this stuff is not to be found currently in the Oxford English Dictionary. And that leads to number seven. As between, it seems to me, treating specialized vocabulary, the disciplines versus slang terms and regional varieties of English, if we have to allocate resources, who's using the dictionary the most? People who want to know what some new slang term, which may exist for a couple of years, maybe 20 years, maybe it'll pass into usage ultimately into standard English, maybe not, but a lot of slang is very deciduous. What we're missing right now are many core terms from the disciplines, and that's where I would allocate the resources. Some type of reading program needs to be undertaken. What a 21st century reading program looks like, it is hard to know, but I think it is more than a printout of word frequencies. It still takes a human mind and a speaker of English to identify what is properly a lexical unit. Word frequency, it seems to be, needs to be covered. And finally, I suggest an ecumenical style. That is a definitional style that is not offensive from a literary point of view to a speaker of standard American English or standard British English. I'm all in favor of British spellings in the OED, but when there are idiosyncratic Britishisms, that seems to me to be limiting the commercial market for Oxford dictionaries in the American market. And the only reason I say both American and British is I think that will cover the core of most, at least what is acceptable from a literary point of view, most world Englishes. One last idea. I've seen in some of the papers the suggestion that we should make everyone his own lexicographer, and that somehow all lexicographers need to do is assemble the evidence and then let people draw their own conclusions. That defining is somehow not a core part of what lexicographers are up to. Two of the papers in advance of this symposium have said that. I think it's quite wrong. Defining is a very difficult thing to do well. Most judges, most lawyers are completely incompetent when it comes to devising good definitions for adjectives, for verbs, etc. And the most important thing that lexicographers do is to define from the evidence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian. And now I'm going to call on Stefan Dollinger to be our respondent.
Thank you very much, Laura. Okay, so how does this thing work? Let me see.
Oh, may I say a word about this?
Go ahead.
Sorry.
No, maybe it is from there.
This is a letter. It's in my collection. It's a letter from James A.H. Murray to some young woman. Dear madam, do not think that ladies who ask by letter for autographs, do you not think that ladies who ask by letter for autographs ought to send their photographs in order that it may be known to what fair faces they are granted? Yours very truly, James A. H. Murray. Who knew? Who knew?
Excellent. Excellent. Thanks for sharing, Brian. Okay, so I'm the role of the official respondent here before we open up the floor, and I was told I have 15 minutes plus two or three, so I'll stick within that limit. Now, I read all the previous versions of these talks, so I have a PowerPoint here that I can present. And I just want to start with one thing here. The clash between the expectation and the reality, and here's a word from the preface of the OED 3 now by John Simpson, and he points out basically here that it's a myth, not every word is in the dictionary, and so on, and that fully comprehensive coverage of all elements of the language is a chimera. That said, the content of the dictionary is certainly comprehensive within reasonable bounds. And that's a very elastic and wisely chosen focus. So, but then of course on the left hand you have like popular books by Simon Winchester here, The Meaning of Everything. So it's, yeah, the OED has to deal with that, of course. If you look at the OED's publishing model defining English, then you can see that this goes into the PR materials as well. Okay, this is a longish slide. Slides you shouldn't pack up like that, but I don't want to bother you with this. It's the treatment from the preface of OED 3 on varieties of English. And it's interesting that there's a lot of good things in there, a lot of interesting and innovative stuff for the time. Just want to point out here that all these sources that are mentioned here, Dictionary of Canadianisms, Dictionary of American, Regional English, Dictionary of New Zealand English and Australian National Dictionary are all inner circle varieties in the catchment model that Danica referred to. For at the time, was a very good focus. I think we need to rethink this a bit, and that brings me to suggestion number one, focus on world Englishes, a more systematic coverage of world Englishes with a focus on the outer and the expanding circles would be a boon, I think. So this goes contra, of course, to Brian's point number seven, but I'll talk about that a little more. So Danica talked about boondog, about bantal, the Webster word, and about batchmate that's found in Philippine and also in Indian English. So that's one of those things where you need to check the attestations, and there are fairly quick ways of doing this. We have to do this in Canada quite a bit. It's the second largest landmass, the second largest country in the world. So when it comes to regionalisms, we have a similar problem. What is actually a Canadianism? What's a regionalism and all? And we figured out a methodology. So that's a question of using digital sources effectively. But still, if you want to focus on world Englishes, what do you do? Well, you run into a catch. Catherine Murray put it in a way, the triple nightmare, space, time, and money. Well, maybe space is no longer the issue, but time and money certainly is. So how much of world English do you want to include? That's something we need to ponder. Suggestion number two, labeling, mentioned before by Danica and by Jonathan. Do we call it Filipino English or Indian English, or what about Southeast Asian Englishes as such? How do we know? Well, I think there are methodologies out there that can help with this. For instance, boondog, from the current OED 3, actually it goes back to the edition series from the 70s. Boondog is labeled as US slang. Well, it should be labeled as North American and maybe not slang at all, as it found in newspaper sources and so on. So there's a few things in the literature on varieties of world English, a field that has snowballed in the last 20 years that didn't exist before, actually. And an early predecessor here is Walter Avis, who says here at the bottom, that actually, after working on, he of course was the chief editor of the Dictionary of Canadianisms, the first edition, and in this function my predecessor. But he actually found out after having published the Dictionary of Canadianisms that actually we should call it North Americanism in many cases and so on. So that's what he thought. Maybe by analogy, there are some regional labels like Euro English or Antipodean English that could be devised. Let's move on to some of Brian's points again. And Brian says that that's his shocking statement, right, Brian? That the length could be trebled. Well, maybe it could even be quadrupled or whatever. But that's certainly a good point. Now, this fits with a focus on world Englishes, fits with the core mission point C, to document the earliest known uses of the terms. And that's no problem. But I would say that the proposed focus on specialized vocabulary is something that would need to be questioned. I would rather focus on something else like English as a world language. So the question here on varieties of literary English, which sounds like British and American is something that I think needs to be really seriously addressed. That's probably more the situation at present, as Danica has shown us. Now, the specialized vocabulary that Brian mentioned is known in the literature as English for specific purposes. That's a very important field. There's no doubt about it. It's a mushrooming field as well. But is it really the one that's most important to be focused on here? And I'd beg to differ here and would ask, well, maybe it's the field of world Englishes or English as a lingua franca, which we haven't touched on yet, so I will mention that in a few sentences later on. Now, I see three options here. Forks in the road for the OED. Now, three avenues to pursue. The first one would be the OED could either focus seriously on world Englishes, stay with British English more or less, or focus on inner circle Englishes. Now, the inner circle focus, I think, would be a respectable choice, but I think it would be regrettable further down the road. If you go back to the Quirk catch-through debate from the mid-80s and the early 90s, in the field of world Englishes or English linguistics, this has been resolved. So that's one thing. A British English focus, would, if this were the choice, would still be a challenging task. If you look at the internal variation within British English, and John F. Miss talked about slangs or spoken language, a challenging task, no doubt. But what would you do with the American English terms if you were to focus on British English more? You would chuck them out, I don't know. According to Graham Diamond, the New Words Group editor-in-chief, no words are kicked out of the OED. Maybe that's something that needs to be reconsidered depending on the choice made here. Now, the world English's focus would be if the status quo of research into world Englishes is taken as a benchmark, OED should treat the outer and the expanding circle Englishes on an equal footing. Now, that's a tall order, but it'd be an important one if one were to focus on world Englishes. This means you treat Filipino English just as much as you treat Euro English on the continent and beyond that. Okay. So, food for thought, but what about slang again? Well, Mr. Slang is here in the audience, powerful advocate. Brian is a powerful advocate for the ESP, English for specific purposes. And of course, here is the OED meaning 3 for slang, what slang is, from 1911, from the first edition. So the colloquial type, the underground type that Jonathan talked about. Now, this reminds me when I read his draft of this movie, Ball of Fire, the 1941 screwball comedy. It might be compulsory viewing for everyone here at OED, I don't know. It's certainly a good movie, but it certainly shows the thing that Gary Cooper, as the youngest lexicographer who's middle-aged, is sort of running into trouble when he tries to get the lingo of the folks on the streets, so the spoken language. And it's a hilarious attempt of how ridiculous lexicographers sometimes may seem, myself included. So that's an interesting thing. How would you get at this? Well, Jonathan says, he just told us before that he doesn't do field work, and I think quite rightly so. He says it doesn't yield results. Well, what you'd like to know, what happens, watch the movie. But one way out is do not do the fieldwork yourself. Train the odd hipster, and they are out there. And they will write the draft entries for you. And it doesn't take as much because I've been training my students now, and my undergraduate students, the good ones, two or three I have now, they can do, within a half a year, they become great helpers. Okay, so they're much closer to the source. Now, what about slang in the OED? Well, there are a couple of options. Jonathan has told us that. Tone down the label of slang, as with his examples from Australia. Abandon the label slang at all. I thought he would yell out loud now. No, but he's sitting here and listening, so maybe that's a thought. My thoughts would be, well, polysemantic terminology terms that mean different things to different people are problematic, especially if the public thinks they know what slang is, so have a use of their own for slang. So maybe we should come up with our own new system here. Neo-Latin terms for dissimulo, for the secret language, or precipus, or whatever we can think of. Suggestion 3, The importance of first attestations, the Holy Grail, the first use, as Jonathan said, is infinitely mutable now. Okay, so let's not place too much emphasis on it while trying at the same time to get new antedatings. Here I have an example from the Canadian, from the Dictionary of Canadianisms of Advanced Green. That's a traffic light switching pattern. We have five types of Canadianisms here. And origin, preservation, semantic change, culturally significant, and frequency terms. And even if we hadn't found, so we had an American citation from quotation from 1966 and a Canadian one from 1986, even if we hadn't found an earlier Canadian one than the American one, we would have still included the term in our dictionary. And we did this on frequency grounds, and that's one of the factors that the previous speakers raised. So here's our frequency chart of normalized frequency indices with Canadian standing out, 25,000 index points, and Australia 10,000, so that's 2.5 times. Okay, let's include it because Australia and Canada are really far apart, and the important part is here that the US, of course, has less than 4,000. So it's a Canadianism fan. So what I want to say about the first attestations is, okay, before I do this, here's another part about frequency. That's for the term cube band, and I'll show you a photo of that in a moment. Here's the definition, and our word story here. The word story, which is the accessible form of an etymology. I call it word story for that reason. First quotation from 84, some cut off, then you see the references, and this is a cube band. If I had asked somebody in Canada what a cube band was, or if I had told them that a cube band is a Canadianism, they would have looked at me and said, what are you, you ESL speaker, what are you talking about? And it's not true. So I need to bring them the data, and this is the data we have for national searches, Canada, UK, and so on. US is very low, 600 index points for Canada. Then we have regional searches for Ontario, Quebec. So if my BC students don't believe me, I can show you the chart and say, that's why. How much are you in touch with people from Toronto? Say, yeah, sometimes. But they're not moving house with them, so they don't know. It is not one swallow that bringeth in summer, so it's not the first attestation that's the most important thing. It's just one part in the puzzle to come up with compelling word stories. Now, how about mixed language texts? Laura is the chair here, but she gave us one of her papers in that context, and what I found interesting is what she came up with. Macaronic medieval text now, so switch back 5 centuries. What do you do with quotations, with attestations of words like back, bach, pipa, that occur in Latin texts but are used as loan words there? Do you use them or not? And sometimes the difference is quite great, to like 5 centuries in the case of Biardum or Bayard from Anglo-Norman, probably as handbearer. What do you do with those? Strictly speaking, it's not in an English text, so you shouldn't include it in the OED. That's why they're not there. Well, maybe that's not such a great idea in the long run. Laura's question is, when does a loanword become English? When does a loanword become English? Forward 5 centuries, you know Wedeln, the Alpine skiing style of zigzagging down a slope in a fast manner. Quotations from 61 to 79 in the OED. PDE usage. Present-day English, it's no longer used because of a technological innovation in skiing, parabolic skis. Germans call it now carving skier or carving skis. Since the late 80s, it's in OED because the media picked it up in England. Good, that's fine, or the skiers there. But what about English words in non-English texts today? So the other way around, and now we come to English as a lingua franca. This is a site from the student point at the University of Vienna. Student point used to be the Beratungszentrum, now it's student point. So you see direct in blue and what I call indirect contact phenomena here. Nobody would have said contact earlier. They would have said Adresse or Brief or something like that. So feedback, that's a direct way of via email and all those things. It's kind of interesting stuff that there's 10 things here on this one slide, and I could have picked any. So my question is, relating to Laura's question, when does a loanword cease to be English? Now, is that stuff that you find in German texts or in Italian or French texts, is that now something to be excluded? Is that not important because it's accented English? Carstensen and Buster looked at English loanwords in German since 1945 to about 1990, late 80s. They discovered 3,000, my count, English everyday present common core loanwords. That's quite a bit. Now, a more recent study, Gormasova in 2010 concluded that the rate of uptake of English words in German increased by almost a factor of 1.7. So if there was 3,000 in 30 years, maybe it's going to be 1,000 or 2,000 since. Here's some examples of German words that are modeled in analogy to English words or direct loans or all kinds of the phenomena that Danica pointed out by saying it's more than just loan words. There's word formation processes on there and there's innovation. Some go back and forth. Scent is not, it's the sound that's odd because the elderly in Austria pronounce it cent, but now more and more cent, and the young ones certainly pronounce it cent, so they talk about 3 Euro cent and not cent, which is phonetic influence here. So there's kind of interesting examples. You could really extend that. I've given you a few more here. Interesting stuff. Ein cooler Typ, cool Antworten. So there's different parts of speech involved, different syntactic functions. There's not just handy for a cell phone, but there's cool things like dress for soccer uniform, you know, Rapid Wien in den grün-weißen Dressen. That's just how it's been, and that's how I grew up with in the 80s. It's there. What to do with it? It's clearly language contact, just like Laura showed in her medieval paper on medieval English, and even on a more massive, I'd say, user-based scale than in medieval times. So if we include the medieval language contact phenomena, shouldn't we look at those more recent ones too? So how is the OED going to reflect such phenomena with English? Or can OED afford to ignore them at all? One more point, the juggernaut, and I don't mean the truck meaning, I mean the important force. If lingua franca English is the most widely used form of English today, if we go by David Crystal, still up to date, I mean most recent count, what does this mean for the OED? Well, here's Barbara Seilhofer's interesting summary. The most widespread use of English, that which from a global perspective actually constitutes the prevailing reality of English with the largest number of speakers, is English as a lingua franca in interactions in which more often than not no native speaker participates. Question, wouldn't ELF, English as a lingua franca, ELF lexis be worthy of description in the OED? You will have to answer this. One thing is for certain, the triple nightmare remains, maybe it's a double nightmare, time and space. And it's of course a real nightmare. And I think the coverage of the outer and expanding circles, including English as a lingua franca, should be put into practice on whatever small or large scale possible. And if this step is not feasible, then the OED might want to refocus on being a British resource and looking at the internal variation that is there and the other varieties of English, including American, as the supporting acts. Back to James Murray, last slide here, one for last. So I hope that his Christmas in 1879, I mean his Christmas, according to his descendant, was rather bad in 1879 because of the problems that were to come in the editing. Well, it's certainly clear that OED is now confronted with a fork in the road because of the unprecedented socio-political reshaping of the role of English in the world. Whatever that decision will be that the OED people will make, I hope that the Christmas 2013 will be more happier than Christmas 1879 for the OED editors. Thank you very much.
I would like now to throw it open to the floor. Any comments, please, for any members or all of the members or all of us, or anything that you would like to say. Particularly, may I encourage those that you disagree with? Would anybody like to oppose any of the points that they have heard?
I'd just like to say that the idea of reverting to a British English dictionary is so absurd that I'd like to rule it out straight away. OED is a world English dictionary. The only question is, how big is the world? Sorry. Did you get that?
Yes. Thank you. And that seems to be relatively uncontentious. I see nobody leaping
Well, it's great, and I'm certainly happy to hear this. But the question is really, how do you go about creating a world dictionary? I mean, the OED is deeply tied, has been tied until recently to Britain, and there was the American dependency, and there's a New York office and all. But still, I mean, if you look at the content, there's a lot of work to do. The question is, how is this being done? I charted my proposal here. I wonder how far people are willing to go with it, or want to go with it, or what's feasible. That's the question.
At the back.
With regard to Ms. Salazar's talk, I think obviously the more Englishes we can include from around the world, the better we do. The notion of trying to work out an effective and usable system for tagging them strikes me as sort of horribly difficult. Just your brief examples about South Asian versus Southeast Asian versus Burma versus Philippines and so on. In the area of internet search, the use of descriptive metadata tagging has more or less completely failed. Is it really practical to try and devise a sort of a universal ontology of regional language tagging? It seems like an awfully steep hill to climb.
I am not well familiar with the technical part of this problem, and I don't expect it to be easy, but I think it is worth doing because, as I said in my own presentation, if we put so much effort into putting all these world English words into the OED, all of that is for nothing if a user cannot find these words. So, because for now, I spent the first few months of my postdoc here in Oxford at the OUP offices looking for Philippine English in the OED as it stands now, and the only way that I could find them was through Pasadena. So I could just imagine someone using the online version finding Philippine English. You have to have a word in mind, a specific word in mind, before you can actually see, oh, this is actually Philippine English. But if someone just wanted to go into the dictionary and see, oh, let's see which words in the English language come from the Philippines, it's very hard to do that. Although you can do it by etymology, by looking for Tagalog, for example, or you can look for Malay, but then that will only direct you to loan words. And then there's also that search refinement option with Southeast Asia as one of the options, but to my dismay, when I used it, I found out that it's not really accurate because it's much more South Asian than actually Southeast Asian. So I don't know how difficult it's going to be, but I think some sort of labeling, so it doesn't of course, it remains to be determined how accurate it should be and how specific, geographically speaking, but I think some kind of way to look at to find words from a geographic perspective is definitely, for me, important, but I admit, difficult.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yep, Tim?
I'm just wondering whether there's been thinking around some kind of delegated model, and franchise would be a dirty word, but it seems to me unfeasible that OED could take full responsibility for world Englishes in all their variety, except by a corpus trick, which I would question. And also, it seems to carry, to me, an element of a post-colonial echo. Why is it that OED would be taking responsibility for Filipino varieties of English rather than Philippine lexicographers developing OED-type coverage of Philippines varieties of English. I'm not sure why that belongs in Oxford, and I'm not sure that I can imagine how world English is done on the scale that British English and the inner circle has been done here could be feasible economically.
So is this support for Brian's point about a reading program, that in the various regions there be some sort of concerted reading program for those world Englishes?
Can I follow up on this? This is a very good point that you're raising here, the question of the post-colonial legacy within the OED. It's something that when you have a reading program of people working for the OED, and then you have the local lexicographer in Oxford drafting the entry based on readings done in the former colonies or non-colonies, that's a problem. That there surely has to be some mechanism of bringing in the people who had to source, or I have no idea, outsourcing some of the drafting. I don't know, but if this is, and this actually ties in nicely to the first comment, there seems to be, I don't know your name, sir, but...
Yeah, Richard.
Richard. There seems to be this attitude or expectation that, of course, English is the world language now. The OED is a world dictionary. Of course, we need to have this. But I'm not sure if it's been fully realized, the implications of all of this for that choice. And this is what you just raised, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I agree. But these are problems to be solved. If we run away from the concept of English as a world language, it is a world language, whether we like it or not. I understand all the post-colonial
stuff. But Oxford is a place, but it's not. Oxford is leave the OED is in a position to take the lead. That's my point.
I believe John's trying to get
in. John?
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, I was up on the question of world English. That was what I was itching to say as well throughout the talk. One of the original OED in the 19th century
did cover...
It attempted to cover a certain amount of world English.
It wasn't called that then, of course. Etc.
Inner circle languages. And one of the reasons why we're now quite successful over the last few decades in covering that
better than we have in the past is because there have been units in those countries, and there's inner circle countries in Canberra, South Africa, etc., that have been dictionary centres that have been, which OUP have often been working with, and in some cases financing to some extent, which have allowed lexicographers on the spot in those countries who know the language in their head and in their heart, and they see the ephemeral documentation for that sort of language on site. And they're able then to create more impressive and better worked entries for their local languages than we would be able to in Oxford. And we've been able to use the OED as something of a sort of central resource where we've pulled in some of that material into the OED, but not all of it. And that's how the situation stood about 10, 15, 20 years ago. We haven't necessarily rethought all that now. What's happening as far as world English is concerned is that we would always prefer, I think, the basic work to be done, or the idea in the past was that the basic work should be done in the Philippines by people who speak the language, who see the documentation, who are familiar with the changes in the language. I mean, it's not just the Philippines, but you know, it might be all the other varieties of English there are, and that it couldn't necessarily be done by. It would be presumptuous of us to assume that we could do it in Oxford, but we'd like. I think in the future, I think the way we're moving now is although we could use some of that material through sort of a Philippine corpus in Oxford, we still wouldn't produce such good materials as Danica and a team of lexicographers working in the Philippines over 20 years would be able to do. And I think from our point of view, one of the good things about Danica being a fellow in Oxford at the moment is that she can, I hope, then maybe go back to the Philippines or set up a unit in you know, America, wherever she wants to go, that would be a focus for that variety of English, which could then publish independently, maybe with collaboration with OUP, and the OED will be able to make use of that information in future. And the information that was coming out of that unit would be much more much better edited than we would be able to do in Oxford. But there would also be units around the world working on other varieties of world English, maybe one working on Euro English if a central location that could be found. And not just from English as well, but also subject areas. I mean, we filter and collect information. When we can't be experts on absolutely everything. We always know there are people out there that know more about anything than we do. So we do the best we can, we publish what we can, but we hope to get more information in externally, which will enable us to both improve the dictionary, and by improving the dictionary, making that available information more widely available nowadays to everybody. So that's sort of background view of what the OED's view on world domination is over the last 10 years and looking forward.
Thank you, and I have to say, as a user rather than as a moderator, world domination is absolutely the way I want to see the dictionary going. I don't want to see anything ruled out of court. I want to see it all potentially used, be it special purposes, be it world English, be it whatever. We've got 5 minutes left, and I'd like to focus on three contentious issues and just test the temperature in the room. Should we abandon the word slang? If we were to abandon the word slang, would anybody in the label slang, rather, would anybody in the room howl?
I would.
Jonathan?
I would.
Thank
you. Yeah, slang. Right. Slang is a definable thing. We need the label. Slang.
It becomes harder to define.
You're fudging everything. It's like many other things. The periphery is a little bit fuzzy, but there is a core.
Head, not your lexicographic.
Yeah, that's the usage writer here, right? Speaking, Brian. Yeah.
Does anybody have a practical use for the label slang in their historical work or their contemporary work? I'm looking now at the academics, really.
Yes, well,
or
lawyers,
the educators
lawyers,
as well.
Lawyers have to decide whether to put something in a brief.
So lawyers do?
Of course.
I think
a lot of literary writers have to decide if something's slang or not.
Tim?
I think in education it's a problematic term because in certainly secondary and upper secondary in England, it's problematic. It comes with the kind of restricted set of terms that people come into advanced study with, you know, posh, common, and slang. And I think I'd be more interested in moving into a model of vernaculars and then subdefining from that.
What would the implication be? That it's not pejorative?
Yeah. I think
it's really isn't it, actually? And I do notice, having done quite a lot of mapping of different editions of the OED, forwards, that a number of things have been slang past have now become informal, actually, and which is a more neutral. I think there is that problem of the constitutive load
which would
that
seem
slang
the way
can
to
with.
Go.
Yeah.
On the principle of what, but you've got to, there's got
I mean
to
a
be
register a, based
yes, it seems
engagement.
To be a place must be found for one multi-ethnic London English and whatever comes after it and wider and so on. But I mean, I tend to be most of the stuff I'm doing is going backwards on this mutable world of first uses, but for the forwards, it's unnerving. Again, we have too much potential knowledge, and it's too hard to corral it in one word. That's what I'm finding all the time.
Yeah, I think it is the fact that it's so densely polysemous, actually, that it can become a very problematic umbrella term, actually. And if it does become an umbrella term, it can actually move discussion today in the wrong direction, actually. So I think something that engages with that informality and vernacularity and whatever. But difficult to do in dictionary, actually.
My slang is not Potten slang or Grocer slang.
It's not a perfect term, but if you eliminate that, the dictionary is under-describing the language. You are taking out part of the descriptiveness of the dictionary.
But it depends, Brian, it depends on the system that you put in place of it instead, you know. You could have it somewhere saying, okay, what used to be called slang is now those five categories and we use them in that way. The reason we abandon slang is because it means all things to all kinds of people. It's just not a scientific term. We can't use it, right? But I do understand, I do hear you what you mean. It's some a term that we all think we know, but I don't think it works in dictionaries.
Comment from the floor?
Yeah, I was just going to say that in my experience of using OED when it comes to what are labelled slang terms, the illustrative quotation provided and the precise source of that illustrative quotation tend to leave one in no doubt about the slanginess of a term, and actually the label, in my experience, is redundant. I mean, you look at the sort of sources that Jonathan uses, you know, if something's a hip-hop lyric, it's for, you know, you don't need a label saying it's slang, because the fact that it's a hip-hop lyric is telling you that.
But what if it's 600 years old?
I still think the nature of the source usually gives some indication.
What if it's an abridged version, the SOED or even the COD, and we've now abandoned slang? And people don't even see the sources.
Well, that, yeah, okay. We're talking here about the whole OED. I mean, you know, maybe slang has a place in the abridged versions.
Because we're running out of time, I've got to call the last two comments. One at the back, and then Lynn.
This is just a hypothesis, but it feels intuitive to say that once you get outside of the sort of inner core of words from Old English and so on, a high proportion of the words that enter the language do so as slang, really quite a high proportion, and thus, to the extent that the label is useful, it would need to have a temporal attachment to it. Yeah, it was slang in 1940, but it's not anymore.
But it seems, I mean, I am not a linguist in any possible way, but my experience is that 75-80% of the slang lexis is exactly the opposite, that these are standard English words that have been tweaked and twitched and turned upside down and inside out and generally pissed around, if I may use a perfect example. And this is what, but you can prove me wrong, and I'm very happy to be proved wrong, but the lexis that I experience, the 53,000 head words on which the rest are based, 54,000, so many of them are taking a word like dog. Dog is there. It's not, I mean, but again, once we move out into the worlds of origins of language and so on, I immediately leave the field. But from the simple point of the imagery, the stereotyped imagery that's associated with the dog, whether it's the cur, cowardly type imagery, whether it's the loyalty imagery, whether it's whatever it is, I can't remember whether it's 14 or 26 different homonyms for dog, plus all the sub-entries inside, sub-definitions inside, but those are based on the standard English. The standard English, to me, seems to have been well in place.
We're a minute over time, so I'm going to take one last comment from Lynn, but we won't answer it. We'll leave it floating. It was a question.
Well, on Brian's point about why that you need labeling, that you need to know whether you can use this word, that seems like a defense of labeling and not a defense of the label slang. So I was wondering if you were actually arguing for the word slang or for it, whether something like informal would do the same job.
These are not trouble-free labels, of course. But I think informal and slang are different. There is a different core meaning. I'm arguing for the continuation of slang, as well as other labels. But it is imperfect. And the mere fact that you can point out imperfections at the periphery does not mean let's do away with it. There are lots, I would say most users of English dictionaries don't have nearly the acumen that Henry Hitchens is suggesting, that people will look at the examples and say, oh, well, look where it comes from, consider the source. Most people consider the source to be the dictionary. And I have to wrestle, I put a lot of legal slang in Black's Law Dictionary. I have to wrestle with when I call something slang to bork a nominee, that is to engage in a campaign, a scurrilous campaign of delegitimizing somebody who's been appointed to a judgeship. I call that slang. So there's a lot of legal slang, but it seems to me that because every dictionary is a snapshot at that time, some slang labels over time will have to come out. But you can't say slang as of 2013, let's wait 5 years and see. You simply put slang in and maybe delete it in 2020 when the editors say it's no longer slang. More likely it's going to be 2090.
Perhaps, can we say that slang is spoken language? Let's look at what the experts with spoken language vernacular do. They don't use the label slang. They use something else.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are 4 minutes into break, and I have to be fierce. So I declare this session closed.
It's all right. No, it's all right.